Abaddon Princess of the Decay is an NES-styled, haunted mansion-type horror RPG that contains adult themes. The game is a homage to Sweet Home, a classic NES horror game which itself was the basis to Resident Evil. Abaddon is very much so like an old 16-bit game but with, you know, the dirty stuff. However, Abaddon is much more than a cheap fling for you to get your rocks off. It is an intricately designed horror game that rewards experimentation. It is a game that is very satisfying to play and replay to discover all the new little details that you didn't catch in your first playthrough. It is one of the best designed horror games that I have experienced, which is why I'm here to argue that you should play Abaddon, Princess of the Decay. Before I get into Abaddon, I just wanted to show you just how similar the game is to Sweet Home. Here they are side to side. You can tell they're really similar. Even the sprite rotation is the same. It really is a spiritual successor to this legendary game. It was directed by Tokuro Fujiwara, which later was the producer for Resident Evil. Although Abaddon is an RPG where you have turn-based battles and you level up, the majority of the time it plays more like a mystery game. You uncover small pieces of the story and you solve puzzles to advance through the mansion. It uses a system where a series of tools gives you access to different parts of the map. A small key will open optional doors, and a plank lets you traverse small gaps, for example. Depending on the tools you have available and what order you solve the puzzles, the story and relationships between characters will change. Many different endings and scenes are uncovered this way. A lot of the tension comes from the inventory system being extremely limited. You generally only have 3 slots per character to carry weapons, healing items, and tools. This tool system is important because it relates to how the characters have been written. Or maybe a better way to say it is that it relates to how well thought out and planned they feel. From the gameplay perspective, each character carries a unique tool that does not take up room in your limited inventory. And since this is also an ecchi dating sim, from a romance perspective, each character is tailor-built for a specific romance preference. The romance targets may be just a bit cliché and one-dimensional, but it works. I like petite tsundere girls, so Dashka's story was fun to learn about, especially her interactions with Rikana, because she's another type of anime girl I like. It's not a deep and human experience, but I still had fun with it. I imagine that with such specifically targeted characters, there's probably one that fills a niche for most people that like anime. Both the tool the character carries and their personality feel important as a player, and it gives you different reasons to change your party composition. Umuda's the main guy. He's the character you control. He carries a water bottle with limited healing charges. He's kind of a blank slate personality-wise. Mia is a nurturing childhood friend type. She carries a first aid kit that heals most combat ailments. Yashka is a petite and energetic tsundere that can open doors and containers with her unique tool, a hairpin. Rikana is the cold older sister type. She has a dictionary that helps you decipher text that uncovers the story or clues. Hippei is the enthusiastic friend. He has a backpack that lets you carry 3 additional items. Seijiro is the cool and mature older brother type. He's a smoker, so he has a lighter that can illuminate dark places. You can see how the game pushes you to decide which character to take in your party, from both a utility perspective and because you might just like the design. There are no bad characters, and the freedom of choice gives you a lot of reasons to try different combinations of people. Having a tool available at different times will unlock a unique item or a new route in the mansion. And having different characters allows you to see how they interact with each other. Some of them even hate being together. And in this game, anyone can be together with anyone else. Guys with girls, guys with guys, is pretty open-minded. Putting the progressiveness aside, I think it's impressive just by the sheer amount of scenes that exist because of the many combinations of characters. But to be honest, the romance and the naughty stuff is just a nice decoration on top of a really solid mystery horror game. Having a multitude of choices is not enough to make a game interesting. You have to do something with those choices, make them matter. Abaddon does this by having an almost obsessive attention to detail to the consequences, big and small, of choosing a path. The simplest and most expansive example is that if you include Seijiro in your party, you explore the east wing of the mansion, a completely different map, with its own triggers and events. It's all of these different paths and all of these different conditions that make Abaddon interesting. It makes you care. There's tons of small bites of story and gameplay that change when you choose different characters, what areas you visited, what items you have, the sanity of your party members. You might just have a normal rest at a save point, or maybe your party members go insane and try to kill each other. Or maybe you experience a completely different part of the story you've never seen before. The choices you make in Abaddon feel like they matter because there will always be consequences, good and bad. When there are bad consequences, the game's horror elements shine through. Abaddon builds suspense by having tough battles and limited resources, very classic survival horror mechanics. The battles at low level will leave your party's sanity in a pretty rough shape. There's safe rooms to recover, but you can only rest once. Healing items are finite, and you can only carry so many because your inventory is shared between all items. For example, there's an insecticide item that can be used to do great damage to bug-type enemies. But not all enemies are bugs, so you have to decide if you'll take it instead of a cookie, which heals sanity. Deciding what item to take and what battles to fight are the key to keeping sane, or the folly that will lead to your downfall. There's always a bit of anxiety while walking the corridors of the Cursed Mansion. There are monsters all around, some of them are pretty creepy, and sometimes a much more dangerous monster will appear that will chase you even outside of combat. And remember all those different events that can happen because the game likes to branch out depending on your actions? Well, sometimes those events are not story or romance related, but something like your party members freaking out and leaving your party. Or maybe your party members decided that they really don't like each other and are going to deal with things brutally. Abaddon is about exploring these multitudes of conditional events that depend on a whole bunch of different flags you set. Even the adult scenes you fall into are part of these conditional branches. Some of them are a treat, and some of them are a punishment. Some pretty messed up stuff happens in this mansion. Abaddon is about dealing with the consequences of your actions, and there's so many little cause and effect events that it keeps fresh, even after a few playthroughs. You might get done in by a powerful monster and defiled in inhuman ways, or you might find a way to make a powerful weapon by following this weird series of esoteric steps, and that's awesome. The events in the game follow a continuity that makes the mansion you're exploring feel almost alive. It makes you want to explore different routes, experiment, and get to know all the characters and uncover all the mysteries. By doing this, the game makes you feel that what you do matters. It makes you care. This is why you should play Abaddon, Princess of the Decay.